In this section, we're going to start theoretically talking about what we call multimodal designs for meaning. And what I'm going to do is introduce a number of concepts which we've developed over a number of decades, actually, around this theory of multi-literacies. And as I define the concepts, what I'm going to do is say how these concepts are different from traditional notions of literacy. In other words, how we're actually expanding on those notions. We're not trying to contradict any traditional notions of literacy. We're trying to expand on those notions and expand on them in a way which is more relevant to the world that we live in, more relevant to a world of digital, multimodal media, more relevant to a world also of diversity, where we're recognizing diversity as an important factor in everything that we do. So I'm going to start with these first two ideas, representation and communication. Now, what we mostly think that literacy is about, it's about communication. So it's about learning to read and write so that we can communicate and be communicated to. It's about the kind of cultural communication that happens in high literary works. And what we often forget is that literacy is also about what we define as representation. Now, these two words, in fact, are often blurred. You know, the meaning of representation is often not as clear as the word meaning of the word communication. And what I want to do is I want to define representation in a very specific kind of way, a little bit narrower than the normal definition, because I want to make a set of distinctions. And that is, representation is communication to oneself, right? If you like, it's like talking to yourself. But what we do is we have these tools of literacy, which in a narrow version is, you know, we might write down some little notes to ourselves, or we might discover that our thinking only becomes clear when we write it down. And this is representation. It's not designed to communicate with anybody. And in fact, before we communicate, we often rehearse things to ourselves. We often say, oh, look, I think I'm going to say this. And you rehearse it to yourself. So that's representation, which is basically communication to yourself. Now, historically, you know, the classical diary, which supposedly no one was ever meant to see, Dear Diary, was just simply thinking things through for yourself. And if it became communication, it was contrary to your initial intentions, but you're just writing it to yourself now. Of course, a lot of the time people were sort of disingenuous about writing it to themselves. They really expected that maybe someday people would find it or whatever. But another example of representation using written language is taking notes. I mean, we're taking notes. You don't actually write them for anybody else to read, by and large. And in fact, if you were to look at the notes that I take, they make no sense to anybody else. They're just kind of mental reminders. So what we often do in this realm of representation is we use language as something that I call a cognitive prosthesis. So, you know, if you're, for some reason, you need a limb to be replaced, a new arm or a new leg, that's called a prosthesis. But what we have, what we often use language for is as a cognitive prosthesis, if you like, as a kind of a new mental arm, something we can add to our thinking capacities, and it actually helps us think. Right. So now, in terms of multimodality as well, it might be a diagram that helps me think. It might be an image that reminds me of something, a photograph that I take in order to remind myself of something. I might use the photograph as a modern day form of writing. So that's what we mean by representation. And the reason why that idea becomes important is the reason why later on, when down the literacy track, you're doing science and you're writing a science argument. The writing helps you think. It's evidence of you thinking, and you don't actually write the science argument because anybody other than the teacher is going to read it. You're not really communicating stuff. Maybe in a nice collaborative classroom, there is communication going on and we read each other's work and we peer review it. That really is communication. But a lot of the time, in the first instance, learning to write a science argument or learning to write an information text in science, for example, is a way of helping you think. It's a kind of a set of formal procedures which, independent of communication, are these cognitive prostheses, things which help us externalize and formalize and systematize our thinking.
Typically, when we talk of literacy, we tend to use the word grammar as the means by which understanding how meaning is made in any particular sequence, a sentence, a paragraph, an essay, a piece of writing, a discussion. For our purposes, though, we use the word design because we see meaning-making as a dynamic experience. It is something that involves creativity and choices. It's not just about formal rules, although, of course, the patterns that emerge in meaning-making are important for us. Literacy changes over time based on the way meaning is made, what we call usage, and the kinds of choices we make. But the first thing I want you to understand is that we're born into a community that has a way of making meaning, a particular language. It might be English, it might be French, it might be German or Arabic, whatever the language is. And with that come a set of values, a set of habits. So we're born into what we call available designs. That is, the resources for making meaning are part of the world in which we ourselves, as young children and as we grow, we engage with these resources in order to learn to communicate with those who are already using those same resources. In the process of making meaning, we are designing ourselves. We are designing meaning. And even though we might be using almost exactly the same words and the same sequence, because it comes from our intention and our purpose, it might have a very different meaning from somebody else. So we are creative as human beings in that engagement, and as we creatively engage, as we make choices, as we test things out, as we try to make meaning in wider and wider domains, we become designers. We are designing meaning out of the available designs. However, by doing that, what we then do is we leave our mark on the world. The world is then redesigned by the way in which we engage in making meaning. We leave behind traces of that meaning that others can take up, and we leave behind a world that is different as a consequence of our engagement in this very dynamic process that cycles through designs, designing, and redesigning.